Very good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to a satellite meeting of the Indian ROP Society. As we have tried now to include our society meeting, other than the annual meeting that we would have, we have tried to create a satellite meeting within the All India framework, and we are very grateful to Scientific Committee Chairman for giving us in the second year the opportunity to meet. Rather than just being a focus group meeting, if when it comes into the agenda, firstly, it gets the eyeballs of other people who might even be interested in managing this disease, but also allows us to have some sort of a charter which we will then push our aims through the society itself, because the work that we want to take on through the society involves not just the limited work that we've all been doing in our areas, but hopefully working as a network. This year we've also made this satellite meeting an opportunity to have an oration, and last year the first Michael Treacy oration was given by Dr. Azad, and this year we have Dr. Narendra from Arvind Coimbatore. So we are going to change the order of speakers a bit, because it's just like more like a family meeting, especially because Dr. Narendra sir has a flight back. They've mixed up my presentation, so I'm going to be waiting just another minute before I actually make a so-called introduction. My introduction is not so much an introduction as it is to actually lay the foundation of the focus of this meeting. This year, we've decided to focus on medico-legal aspects, because it's really coming behind our heels, and with a lot of people asking us what are the possible ways they can tackle these potential litigious situations, or actually some of them are in the situation and they have been writing to us separately. So the idea of this whole meeting is to then come out with some learning from what experiences the society and other ROP members, both pediatricians and ophthalmologists, have had, and see whether we can improve our best practices, and eventually maybe come out with a charter of these are like the desired practices, and these are sort of mandatory, and then these are desirable. And if we then circulate that through all the IROP members, and eventually through VRS and AIOS, at least there'll be a standard way in which we are interacting. Interestingly, the venue of this conference is Indore, and Indore itself has been a home to one of the largest, or probably second largest, court settlements against the ophthalmologist in ROP. So I think it is very apt that we talk about it right here. There'll be a small piece of paper floating around. Please include your name and mobile number and email address, and please indicate. Sorry? I don't know. How come? If you do this, it will come. Right, so IROP Society started in 2015, when we had it in Bangalore, and 2016, I'm sorry. But interestingly, it has taken more than 2.5 years to officially register it. We're very fortunate that we are now a registered society. Actually, for formality, we are registered as a trust, but we will work exactly as a society. And last GBM, we took the consent of the members to register it as a trust, only because it was easier to manage two people coming into one geographical area than seven, which is the minimum requirement to have it as a society. But in all other aspects, it will work as a society. So this happened just a few weeks ago, and our deadline was this AIOS. So this is going to be the exactly where the we are going to lay the foundation of this today's focus meeting. It all started here on July 1st, 2015, where 1.38 plus some amount of compensation, leading to almost 1.8 crores, was probably one of the largest settlements in the field of ophthalmology. It shook, I think, all of us, the entire medical community. Interestingly, they couldn't have picked a better day. July 1st is celebrated as the World Doctors' Day, and all the health secretaries of all the states that day, on that day, were in Dehradun. I think they have their annual some sort of a review meeting. You can imagine the headlines. And just 4 days after that, and Dr. Narendran will remember, the health secretary of Tamil Nadu called all the ROP stakeholders to see how this can be prevented from happening again, because obviously this happened in Chennai. And that led to a very large statewide program in Tamil Nadu and subsequently other states as well. So the one good thing that this has created, the good thing, is that it has created a lot of awareness within the bureaucracy and of course pediatricians, and today pediatricians are coming knocking on your door. Unfortunately, I don't think we are well equipped in terms of human resources to tackle this problem. We have a small publication from the Indian ROP Society where we looked at about 120 initial members. This has grown to almost 200 now. 10% of them are still unsure of the treatment they are doing. And this is, of course, a blinded, masked survey where they were asked, are you comfortable doing ROP lasers? And these are supposed to be the cream of our ROP specialists. So what this has created is, unfortunately, inadequately trained specialists where they are documenting somewhere on their files that they have treated these babies adequately. But when you look at them in reality, not a single spot has happened where it's supposed to, and whereas there are some laser spots in normal retina. And Dr. Azad sir calls this homeopathic laser, and it is unfortunately some amount of laser done in some areas that are not really required, and these eyes are now progressing to blindness. And what's happening now is mothers, parents are getting very aware, they're Googling, they come to you after a diagnosis is made, after injections are given, and then they come to get an image done. I recently got an image report from a mother in another city, and she had asked for the report from that city, and they had a camera, and they just wanted to know whether the treatment that was suggested was actually required or not. So this is where we are coming to now, and that report can easily be obviously shared with the lawyers, and that's where it's a problem. And unfortunately, 22,000 ophthalmologists, almost 2,000 VRSI members, and less than 200 actively practicing ROP. And these babies, by senior retina people, are being treated like this. Many of them are going visually impaired and even blind because of the treatment rather than the disease. And you can imagine a photograph like this landing in the hands of a lawyer. And a photograph cannot be morphed, it cannot be edited, and this acts as direct evidence against the treating doctor. So you can imagine what kind of a legal issues we are going to have going forward. Plus, unfortunately, there is the indiscriminate use of anti-VEGF. I get at least one or two times a month, sometimes even more often, mothers who come with their babies with opinions that the anti-VEGF is required from some other place, only to see that they don't have ROP at all. And there are charges made of about 40,000 rupees per eye, 80,000 rupees for both eyes, and sometimes re-injections advised, and sometimes these babies don't need treatment at all. So where are we leading to? I mean, so because anti-VEGF is an easy thing to do rather than laser, and it doesn't leave a scar, and they're giving injections, and a week later they're sending it for review when everything anyway would look so much better. If this baby is interspersed in between by another expert who testifies against the first ROP specialist, where are we going to lead? Plus, we have now Government of India creating a vertical program for ROP. Under the RBSK, among 30 conditions, ROP is one of them. So now we are directly accountable. At least in Karnataka, every month we give them the statistic of how many babies were supposed to be screened and how many are getting screened. And the district officer has to sign off how many babies were not screened and why they were not screened, whether they went against medical advice, whether they died, whether they were transferred out. So some accountability is happening from the government itself. So we cannot escape today the line listing of these babies who are supposed to be treated or at least screened. And we now have operational guidelines. You all have seen the RBSK guidelines. That was for everything. This is specifically for ROP. So now that we have a guideline, if you can just go back to that Supreme Court judgment in 1998, the accused said that ROP was not standard of care in India. And the court said that you claim to be a tertiary care center, then you should have been following practices that are followed across the world. If ROP screening was standard of care in the UK and the US, and you are in 1998 a tertiary care center, you should have followed it, or at least sent it to a center who was screening. Today, the situation is different. Today, there is a working operational guidelines. I don't think we can say it's not standard of care. We are absolutely told which babies to screen, when to screen, how often to screen, when to discharge. Everything is now laid out. If we have access to this document, so do the lawyers. So I'm just worried from a perspective from the society, and this has been our crying worry, but how are we going to tackle this? So to deal with these topics, we have leading experts who are going to dissect the entire legal problem. So before I end, I just want to invite you all to the meeting, the fourth annual meeting of the IROP Society. I'm not sure if you can read it from there. So this year, we have changed it from the third week of July to the third week of June, because we are hosting it in Chandigarh, and it's in the honor of Dr. Dogra, who retires on June 30th. So to accommodate this during his tenure, we are holding it in June. So, of course, members of the IROP Society have this detail as well, but for those who need to know more detail, you can message me, and I have that my phone number and my email address, anandvinaykar@yahoo.com, or on the website itself, you will find the detail. Okay, so now we are switching orders a bit, as I mentioned, and it's my pleasant duty to introduce today our Michael Treacy Oration awardee, Dr. V. Narendran. So Dr. Narendran is the Chief Medical Officer and heads the Department of Retina and Vitreous Services at the Arvind Hospital, Coimbatore. He has been the member of the task force from 2013, and he also serves as the honorary member of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee Trust, UK. After having completed his MBBS in Madras University, he went on to complete his ophthalmology training in the Arvind Eye Hospital. He's visited in, completed observerships in the US and has numerous awards and achievements and publications to his name. His great contribution and his work very close to his heart has been the ROP program, which he has led from the front all of these years. And today, he's going to be talking about the journey of the ROP program at Arvind Eye Coimbatore. Dr. Narendran, sir.